Hey, everybody.
Hey, y'all.
Welcome back to another fantastic edition of the show. We are grateful to have your ears, your eyes tuned in, because you could be listening and watching a whole bunch of other stuff, but you are here rocking with Talent and Ty. Thank you. We appreciate you. If you hear anything that you love in this episode, of course you will. I don't even know why I'm asking that question. But if you come across something that really hits you, do us a favor. Share it. Don't be stingy. Other people need to hear this too, especially the people in your contacts.
That's
so
right.
Make sure you text it to them, put it in your IG stories, and tag us at His and Her Money so that we can show you love back. We got another powerful episode lined up for you, as always, because we don't have no weak episodes over here, do we, Ty?
No.
Not one. Okay.
We also learned
600 episodes later.
And we learned a lot from our own episodes.
For sure. And you're going to learn a lot from this episode as well. We're going to be talking with Patrice Washington, our homie,
our sister, our family.
But she is knowledgeable. She is really targeted on her audience and really hits areas of finance that you don't think are areas of finance, to make sure that you are well-rounded and holistic in your pursuit of wealth. And we're going to be talking about that. We're going to be talking about wealth on this episode, redefining it, as a matter of fact, because some of y'all definitions is all messed up. And so we got to come up with some new definitions, and Patrice is going to help us do that. So let's not delay this any further. Okay. Let's get Patrice on so we can hear her wisdom on this topic. Hey, Patrice.
Hey, Patrice.
Welcome back to the His and Her Money Show.
Oh, I'm so happy to be back. I always love being around you guys in any format, in any way, always.
Same.
The feeling is mutual, man. We remember when we first met.
We were new to the entire finance.
Nobody knew us. Everybody knew you.
Yes.
And nobody knew us. And we showed up at the airport.
Do you remember the city?
Ooh, where was the first one we went to?
Was it New Orleans?
Nope.
North Carolina?
The one after New Orleans. Charlotte. Charlotte.
Yes, it was Charlotte. And we remember running into her at the airport, and she was beautiful, like fancy, had a nice dress on. Like, I'm like, I go to the airport with sweats and a t-shirt, not Patrice. And I'm like, that's Patrice. And we walked up to her, and she was so, that's one of the things that we've always said.
Never forgotten.
You were so kind to us, and you were not above us or anyone.
Even though you was on everybody's TV.
Yeah, and she wasn't. Was like, y'all going to the same? Come on, y'all want to jump in my car? She ordered a car, and we all got in her car, and she's was just, and she also let us interview her.
Cool as the other side of the pillow.
Yes.
Always.
Absolutely. We will never forget that. So thank you.
And so we reciprocate that now. When people come up to us, we get our Patrice on, and we just keep
that's
it cool.
So true.
You know what I mean? So that's something we'll never forget. That's something people need to know about you, is that you're cool.
She is very kind.
But for some people, in real life. Yeah.
Exactly.
We've experienced that.
We have. No, she is the real deal.
So for those who are being introduced to you for the first time right here, right now, can you say hello to them and let them know what you're all about?
Hello there. So again, my name is Patrice Washington. I'm super excited to be here. What am I all about? In this stage of my life, I believe my purpose has evolved to be more about teaching this generation about how to redefine wealth for themselves. I believe, and I know you guys can attest to this, for many years, we were raised to believe that wealth was just about money and material possessions. And so it wasn't until I had my come to Jesus moment, like my bathroom floor experience, after I had done all the things, right? Thought I had gone to school, got good grades, graduated, started a business became really successful. And then I lost everything in the recession, literally went from building a 7-figure business to scraping up change, applying for food stamps and being on welfare. And my life, it felt like in an instant had just changed. And one of the things that I will never forget that come to Jesus moment was being in the bathroom, you guys, asking God, why me? Like, I've been a good person. I operate in integrity. Like y'all said, I'm cool. I try to be cool with everybody. I don't bother people. I do my work. I go about my business. I'm like, God, why me? Like, why would I be in this place? And it started with just like in the mirror, God, why me? And then turned into me bawling and snotting and crying and yelling out, God, why me? That turned into me balled up on the floor in fetal position saying, God, why me? And I was questioning and questioning until I heard what I call that still small voice say, get your Bible. And I ended up grabbing my Bible from my bedroom. And I found the scripture, or the scripture found me, but Proverbs 17:16. And it said, what good is money in the hands of a fool if they have no desire to seek wisdom? Mm-hmm. And from that moment, I was like, seek wisdom. I'm smart. I went to school. I got good grades. And I just started to like really look up definitions. Like I'm that person who's like, okay, well, what does this mean really? Maybe I've been saying it wrong. And that's the first time I learned, you guys, that there was a difference between knowledge and wisdom. We just use them interchangeably. Not so. Knowledge is information, education. You know, now that we have podcasts, you know, and audio books at our fingertips, a lot of people think they're smart out here, right? They're like, oh, I got information. Mm-hmm. Knowledge, that's information, but wisdom is knowing how to apply it. So I looked up the definition of those two. And then there was another thing that I'll really mention. It was wealth. And that same day I was looking up wealth and I saw that the first definition was money and material possessions. But then the more I went down, I saw that the original definition was the condition of well-being. So it's like, well, what does that mean? Well-being, happiness, fulfillment. I'm like, how are those things in the same definition? Like how, right? So the whole time that I started to, you know, get off the floor and rebuild my life and do all the things that you guys mentioned, like the television, the radio and all these things, people thought that I was just focused on budgets and credit reports because that's what I talked about on television. I talked about whatever the media people wanted me to talk about, right? The buzz things. How do you save, right? How do we pay off debt? But what I was doing for myself every day was figuring out what are the parts of my life that I need to work on that'll help me be well. If the original definition of wealth was the condition of well-being, what do I need to do in my life to be well? And this new book, Redefine Wealth for Yourself, and my podcast, right? That is the byproduct of that. Like, I want to share with people what I believe to be the truth about wealth. So even though I was known for so long as a finance expert, I don't even talk about money. I leave that to all the other great people. We have so many people in the space now. I leave that to them, but I tell from my perspective, you know, what I did to rebuild my life. And it wasn't just looking at credit.
Yeah. And you've done a fantastic job. We've been following you over the years and we've seen your platform. Yeah. Evolve to where it is today. And our hats go off to you because you're absolutely right. There's so much more to wealth than just money. And believe it or not, a lot of the things that you talk about, even in your book, will impact your money. So it's like sometimes people are looking at how to make more money. How do I get out of debt? How do I budget? And they're forgetting the other aspects of their well-being that will in turn also impact that, right? And so you do a really good job talking about that in your book. Talk about, in the beginning of your book, you talk about an experience. You were at the doctor. I believe you were pregnant with your daughter, if I'm not mistaken. So talk about the beginning. What was your aha moment where you were like, it's more to this than just the money?
I think you're actually referring to when I got food poisoning.
So
I was at the emergency room because I got food poisoning. And, you know, they were running the tests and, you know, doing all the vitals, the basic stuff and hooking me up to the IV for fluids. And the young man came in and he said, ma'am, do you know that you have more problems than just food poisoning? And I was like, first of all, sir, I'm grown. That's not how you talk to a lady. No, I was like, no, I don't know what you're like. What are you referring to? And he's like, your hemoglobin levels are really low. So a woman of childbearing age, you should be like a 12 to whatever. I was like a 4 point something. And he's like, you're on fumes. You're running on fumes. Did you pay attention to any of the signs? And I'm like, well, what are the signs? Fatigue. Well, I'm on my hustle and grind. I'm supposed to be tired because that's what we're taught, right? You're trying to build a business. You're trying to do your thing. So we hear all of these things like team, no sleep, be on your hustle and grind. You do your thing, all this stuff. Wake up early, go to sleep late. Well, I had normalized being tired. I had normalized being out of breath. I thought that because I looked thin, that automatically meant I was healthy. And so being at that doctor's appointment, or that wasn't even a doctor's appointment, just being in the emergency room and having this conversation, literally everything he listed, I realized I have been suffering from those symptoms for a long time. And, you know, as a mom, I'll say, if my child was constantly talking about those types of symptoms, I would have made an appointment for her immediately. I, though, you know, we like to either WebMD and try to figure out our own, diagnose ourselves, or we just ignore it and we just push through. And, you know, I got so accustomed, I learned how to through very young, right? So here I am pushing through, and the guy says, if you were in a car accident right now and you bled, you could die because you would bleed out. You don't have enough blood. Like, you don't have enough blood. They said, if you're any older, we would be rushing you to have a transfusion right now. We're going to give you an opportunity to get to a hematologist this week and get an iron infusion so you can start building this up. And it just, you know, that part of the book, Ty, it's the fit pillar. That's what you know, we have the six pillars of wealth at Redefining Wealth. And in that fit pillar, what I just share with people now is like, look, if God gave you a vision for your life, it's your duty and responsibility to protect the only vessel you get to execute that vision. We get one body. And we think because we're trying to build a business, it's okay to run it into the ground. Okay, we hear health is wealth, but then how serious are we about that? Like, are we paying attention to the signs? Are we listening to our bodies? Are we doing the things that we need to do to make sure that we can actually, you know, enjoy all this stuff we say we're working for?
Yeah, and that was interesting in reading your book. Because I didn't have context for where we were going to go with the books. I just started reading it. And okay, I'm like, okay, where's the stock advice? Where's the debt payoff strategies? You sitting here talking about we need to run more. I'm like, wait a minute now. Hold on. First of all, you don't know me like that. No, but seriously, why seriously do we need to take an approach of looking at our physical well-being before we start talking about dollars and cents on this journey to redefining what wealth actually is?
Because there is no wealth literally without health. Like, if you are not here to enjoy it, what good is it, right? So many of us, we are working really to pay for prescriptions in our future that we can't even pronounce.
Whoa, say that one more time.
We are working today to pay for prescriptions in our future that we can't even pronounce. We will say that we don't have time to take care of our physical body. We don't have time to eat well. We don't have time to move our bodies. We don't have time for that. But what about all the time you're about to spend in the doctor's office? Many of us as Black and Brown people on diseases that could have been prevented. Preventable diseases, not things that were passed down to you, right? Things that could have been prevented. You didn't have time, but we're going to pay for it now or later. You get to choose, and you get to choose how you pay for it. But it's inevitable, right? We don't take care of ourselves. And it's not to say freak accidents can't happen and all those things, but there's a lot of things that are within our control, you know? And even beyond that, one of the things you guys even talked about, okay, the first time we met and how, like, you know, I'm like, hey, I'm in there. Like, what are we doing? Hey guys, right? I think about, you know, what my purpose has required me to do, which is, it requires me to be personable and stand there. You know, when I speak, I hug and talk to every single person. If there's an opportunity to do that, you know, this is all pre-COVID, but if there's an opportunity to do that, that's who I've always been. In my book signings, I've always been the person. I'm not going to sit down while I sign the book. I'm going to stand there and talk to and lock eyes with every single person if I can. But I have to be well to do that. Like, I have to be in a good space to do that. And I don't think we realize how it impacts whatever it is we say we're building in more ways than one. And so, and it's not just about being physically fit. Y'all know I also believe it's about being mentally fit. Mm-hmm. Yep. Because I think that a lot of us ignore, like you guys said, 600 episodes?
Something like that. Yep.
600. Child. Okay. Well, 600 episodes, right? You have said probably everything under the sun about all types of money topics. And I bet you still get people that call, DM, email, and they're like, but I just don't know how the budget's going to work for me. It's like, okay, first, why are you special? Why are you trying to make this hard? Why are you trying to, like, create confusion here? It's because their minds don't have the capacity to receive. you're not necessarily fit in your mind yet. A lot of us have been through a lot of things in our childhood. We've seen things, we've heard things, we've experienced things, and it has clouded our ability to receive even the most basic information.
Yeah, so true.
So instead of putting it into action, we're going to ask over and over and over again. And I believe that our wealth, what could be, how do I want to say this? I believe that what could be on the other side of our wealth is like us going to sit down on somebody's couch and maybe process where we got limiting beliefs from, what is our childhood trauma, dealing with those things so that when somebody brings us an opportunity or somebody brings us information, somebody brings us wisdom, we can finally receive it and let it in. No matter what we say, if you have a block, there's nothing we can do about that.
So true.
Yeah. Another way that you talked about strengthening our mental capacity is that you meditate on scripture. Can you talk about how to apply
the six pillars?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. How to apply that on our journey to redefining wealth as well?
You know, when I was younger, I used to think that faith was about memorizing the Bible. I don't know about y'all, but I went to a church where it was like, oh, read the Bible in 365 days. So I was reading to read. Like, I knew how to read, so I would read the words. They didn't necessarily mean anything to me. And it wasn't until I, you know, as I started to develop my own faith, because for so long I had borrowed my mom and my granny's faith. I heard them say things.
Wait a minute. How many of us are borrowing our mom, our grandmother's faith, our parents' faith?
That's yeah. Like it's a library book.
Man.
Yeah. I was just borrowing their faith. Whoa. You know, you remember in church, you know, like, oh, Sister Jones used to have that one line. Now, you don't really understand why that was her line, right? But I just adopted all these little cliches in it. You know, I realized, I would say around the same time that I lost everything, which, you know, sometimes you got to be humble. That's the thing that does it, right? That I had read all these things in the Bible, but I didn't make them life applicable. I didn't understand how they really apply to me. And so, you know, I believe that on this journey to building wealth, life is always going to happen. You know, I don't care if you're an entrepreneur following your passion and your purpose. That's not going to stop life. Life is still going to happen, even when we're being purposeful, right? But I think that many of us, like you guys in the 600 episodes, blowing my mind. I'm like, I don't know if I ever see it, Lord. you know, it. But it takes, there's so many reasons that you could have stopped along the way. There's so many things that I know, I don't have to know details that have come up where it would have been easy enough to say, you know what, this is good. We've done it. But there is a blessing on the other side of our obedience and our consistency. And I don't think we realize that so often we're saying that we're praying for these things, whether it be the business, the career, the money, but you haven't built the muscle to help you get through those times that are going to come to distract you. They're coming. It's not a matter of if, it's when. So I believe that the faith pillar needs to be a part of this whole conversation, because if you do not have a way that you have learned how to move through resistance, every time the wind blows, you're going to give up. And, you know, I love the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah had to stay on the wall, right? Like that idea of like, stay on the wall, like stay committed to this assignment that you have. Most people don't get what I believe God has for them because they're not committed to the assignment. So every time something happens, you know, they was interested. So their interest falls off. I don't feel like it. I'm not up to it. I don't know. So-and-so don't like it. I don't want to offend. If you will stay in your word and do what your word tells you to do, all of those outside influences don't really matter, because this is not about what anybody else likes or doesn't like about what I do. This is what I'm called to do. And I know who called me. So I'm committed.
Legal & General America is the leader in low-cost term life insurance.
For nearly 70 years, Legal & General America has been providing financial protection to over 1.3 million families and businesses.
LGA makes understanding and applying for life insurance easy.
You can get a free quote by simply going to hisandhermoney.com/LGA.
I love this holistic approach to redefining wealth. Another pillar that you discuss is people. taking care of your relationships. And you also talked about a point in time in your marriage, how you had to invest in it. And I think this is so prevalent now to really talk about it, because especially during the pandemic, a lot of husband and wives were at home. And they were probably spending more time together than they ever have probably their entire marriage, right? And some of them were even challenged by the pandemic, and some of them were even brought closer together. But talk about the importance of taking care of the relationships that are in your life.
That was really big for me and I discovered it, like all of these lessons, right? You discover it just as you're living life. And around the same time that I met you guys, I'll tell you, it started with my daughter, like my awareness of being present. And my family really started with my daughter. It may have been the same season where I met you guys, where I was going from place to place to place.
I remember you talked to us about that. Yep. That was during the time.
On the road. Yep. I was on the road. I was going from place to place. And you know, as a mom, I struggle because as much as I know I was called to be a mother, I knew I was called to be Money Maven, right? Which I don't even use that name anymore, but I knew I was called to be both. And I'm like, well, I'm doing this for her. I'm doing this for my daughter, which a lot of us say as parents, I'm doing it for them. And I was going from place to place, and I already carried that mom guilt. I carried the guilt of like, oh, I missed the thing, or, oh, I was here. No, I was doing that. And I remember I came back from like some series of speaking, or it might've been a tour or something. And I was talking to my daughter in the kitchen, and she kept calling me Miss Angela, which was the nanny's name. And she was fired up telling me this story about whatever was popping in first grade or whatever, kindergarten, first grade. And she was like, and Miss Angela. And I'm like, Reagan, it's mommy. And she's like, yeah, mommy. And she finishes the story. But my heart was breaking every time she said Miss Angela, because I'm like, she's become so accustomed to talking to her. And then on top of that, I pick her up from school. She's telling me a story. And, you know, she talk a lot like her mama. You see, I have no shortage of words. And she's talking, but you know, when little kids tell a story and they're like, and then, and we never get to the then, like, it's just on and on. So she's talking to me. I'm sitting in the car and I'm scrolling on Facebook and I'm smiling because I'm reading something funny. And she says, why are you smiling? This is a sad story. Convicted. And I was like, you know what? I confused working from home and being in her presence when I was home with being present. I wasn't a present parent. I'm gone. I'm speaking. I'm doing my thing. But then when I'm home, even when we were at the table, everybody, you know, we had phones out. She had a tablet. You know, I wasn't being present. And that was one of the times where I made the decision that I never want to be a public success and a private failure. I don't want to be out here going to schools, going to colleges, talking to everybody else's daughters. And they'd be like, oh, Miss Washington, I love you and blah, blah, blah. And then I get home and my daughter's like, oh, she back. That's not. And our relationship is beautiful today. But taking that stand back then is why we are where we are now. And why she can support what I do and why she loves what I do. Because when I'm in her presence, I'm present. Right. But when I'm out doing my thing, she allows me to be free. Just like my husband, it's not like this love hate thing with what I do. They're like, mom's serving people. Like, she's good. We support her. We're going to hold it down. And then when I'm here, I turn my phone off. I'm present.
Good. That's dope. Another way that you said that we should like really evaluate people in our life. You had, and I'm not quoting it exactly, but I remember it. And it was a really powerful statement. You said that essentially we're still in love with expired relationships, and we haven't recognized that some people don't need to be there anymore. Help us navigate that process.
Oh man, this was something I had an experience with even just a few years ago. You guys, I had a thing about romanticizing relationships that had expired.
Like, that's how you said it. So you said it so much better. You said it so much better. I'm sorry. I messed it up, but I remembered
it. No, you good. No, you good. You got the gist of it though, that, you know, we hear people come into our lives for a reason or a season and all these things. But a lot of times the season will be up and we're still holding on. Like, we're still trying to force relationship with people who are not necessarily good for our purpose. They're not good for where we're going. And maybe we're not good for them, right? As well, for what they need to do. But in this one particular situation, I had watched the person perform badly with other people. And y'all know my spirit is not like, I'm not really with that. Like, I don't do people talking to people real crazy and all this stuff, right? Like, I can be tough love, but you know there's love. You know it's not like I'm just being rude or manipulative or any of that stuff. Well, I watched this person be this way with other people. And because I wanted to extend our season, I turned a blind eye to their bad behavior. I just kind of like, okay, I wasn't in touch with what my core values are, not just as an entrepreneur, just as a woman, as a person, as a believer, as a like, what matters to me. It's not good enough that you're nice to me and you like wreaking havoc on everybody, like on everybody else. But I was sitting in this position of like, well, I mean, she don't do it to me. So, I mean, she no better than do it to me until she did. And then I was like, well, you can't act like you didn't see the signs coming. You stayed in this relationship longer than you should have because you thought you had the audacity to believe that you were above someone else's bad behavior. Who do you think you are? And then the turmoil that created, because we stay in these relationships where we're not necessarily addressing head on, like, you know, the conflict. We're trying to like, avoid the conflict, right? But really we're creating all this internal conflict in ourselves. And now I'm not sleeping and I'm like tossing and turning and how am I going to untie that? And it's like, girl, this should have been done a year ago. You playing. You're making this harder for yourself. But the way that all connects even back to wealth, right? The time and energy that I spent on thinking about all of these things with this relationship could have been spent on building something in the business. It could have been spent on learning a new money habit. It could have been spent on learning what I wanted to invest in next. We don't realize how we allow these relationships to consume so much energy. And then now you don't have time to put into the things that are actually going to help you get to where you say you want to go because you want to stay in a relationship that's past the season. People matter. The people you surround yourself with matter in this whole thing. And the other side I have to say is also understanding with the people pillar that there's always someone watching you who has the power to bless you. But who are they watching you be? We don't realize, right, how powerful the relationships are in our life, you know, and how a lot of times we're always looking for someone else, the bigger person, the person with the bigger platform, or we want to be connected to certain people because we think that's going to be the thing. But then we neglect all the other people that are already there, ready to be an advocate, ready to be an ally, ready to ride for us. But we don't even really show people how they can, you know, support us in our vision because our eyes are focused on, oh, this person over here. But there's someone else watching you that's ready. They're ready to make the call. They're ready to do the email introduction. They're ready to support like whatever you have going on. And you're playing them to the side because you don't think that they're big enough. My career has been built on a whole bunch of smaller relationships that people wouldn't even know. And they're like, oh, you know, Steve Harvey. Okay. That wasn't the highlight of my life. You know, like so many of the things that I've done that have really helped create this path or pave the way for me were from relationships with people that y'all wouldn't know their name, but they were advocate. But I had to also get comfortable sharing with people that this is what I see for myself.
So good. You guys have to grab her book. We'll make sure that we have the links in the description box as well as in the show notes. Now, you do talk about money in your book. That's one of the pillars, but you talk about attracting the prosperity that you desire. Talk about that. How can we attract the prosperity that we desire?
So for me, you know, in my last book, Real Money Answers for Every Woman, I did a lot, all the tactical stuff, right? In this one, I really wanted to focus on helping people change their mindset. Cause I do believe we could have all the skill set knowledge in the world, but if your mind is not in position to receive it, then we just talking in circles, right? So with this book, I wanted to share different things. Again, things that I've done. I was just out this weekend for a birthday party, honey. One of these days, I was dressed to the nines, y'all. Y'all know I had my heels on, and you know, that's a big feat putting on heels in COVID. Like I was, you know, in times of COVID, I had heels on, I was dressed up, and we were walking from this restaurant, and I saw a nickel and a bunch of pennies. And I just, you know me, I was like, oh, I'm a money magnet. Look at how this money was just waiting for me. And I stopped and picked it up. And there was a guy, a young fellow that was in the group of people. He's 29 years old. And he looked and he was like, you pick up change? And his face was disgusted. Like he was so disgusted. I'm like, I'm gonna sanitize my hands anyway. Yes, I said I pick up change because I want to teach. I say the universe, but I really think it's about showing appreciation for the money that comes into our lives. So we think it's about the denomination. I believe it's about the discipline and the respect. Because how, like, I think that who we are with $100 is who we are with $100,000. If you don't have any regard or respect for $100, what makes you think that getting $100,000 all of a sudden you're going to be fantastic and have this great respect with money? No, I show appreciation and respect, even if it's a penny, because I'm just showing that, like, I care. I want you. You definitely want me. Like, let's all come together. And it's just been my ritual. I've been doing that for many years. I mean, probably at least 12 years at this point. And it's to the point where I find $100 bills. My husband's always like, nobody finds more money. I find $10 bills. But what I have learned is, it's taught me not to be afraid of who's around when I want to go for something.
Come on.
That's a word right there.
The reason that we don't go for a lot of the opportunities that could get us closer to our wealth is because we're concerned about who's around.
Come on.
I watch it all the time in the airport. Yep. People throw their change around or they don't stop. And I watch people look at it and walk by it. And I'm like, well, how many times in your life do you look at opportunities that could produce money? And you're like, that looked like work. Or people are watching. I'm too dressed up. What do people think? The reason we don't do the stuff we know we should do with our money now is because we're afraid of what people think, as opposed to just honoring and respecting what we do already know.
That's so good. That, like, one of my pet peeves is seeing balled up bills in your wallet or purse. I'm like, no, straighten it. Make sure it's all in the same direction. Like, it's a respect for money. It's a gratefulness, right?
Yeah.
For it. And you appreciate God for giving it to you. So you want to be disciplined or in that area. So pick up the penny, pick up the quarter, whatever it is. Don't be afraid. I love how you broke that down.
Yeah, man.
That was good.
You also shared a powerful story that I think people need to hear. Well, you shared a lot of good stories, but this one stuck out because we have a lot of couples that are listening and people may see you and you're here now. You've been here, there, and everywhere, every publication, every TV show, books everywhere. But you know, you came, as you alluded to briefly in the beginning, you hit some rough times, and you shared this story where you and your husband had to turn in your matching Range Rovers and you were left with this yellow cargo truck, your husband in the driver's seat, you in the passenger seat, and your baby daughter in a car seat in the back of this cargo van. I want you to rewind back to that moment, because it may be some people right here, you know, the pandemic could have hit them hard and they're trying to figure out, can we get through this? Can we get out of this? Can we get over this? You all did. We see where you're at today, but go back to sitting in that passenger seat and where you were feeling, questioning things, and give that person listening right now some hope for the future.
So the lesson in the book that refers to this, it was about creating daily mantras. And so at that time, when I was in New Orleans, I was in Metairie, Louisiana. So you're right. We went from a 6,000 square foot home in Southern California, matching Range Rovers, to living in this 600 square foot box of an apartment. And we had this yellow cargo van that didn't have tags or insurance. So we was riding dirty and all that because, hey, you know, when you have a choice between milk and insurance, I'm going to choose milk every time. That's what it was at that time. And Yeah, we used to ride. We used to take that van everywhere, y'all, and park 3-4 blocks away and walk because we still had our good clothes, so we were still suited and booted. We just, you know, we didn't want people to see us getting out of the yellow cargo van. But one of the things that we learned to do together, we didn't call it this at the time, but looking back, we created this mantra. So we would be out there driving in this car, embarrassed, scared all the time. Every time you look in the mirror, you kind of like, oh crap, are they about to pull us over? Are they about to figure out there's a baby down here with no seatbelt, like just in the car seat? And it could have been a time when we were bickering, because that's what happens, right? You have to blame someone. You want to blame something, someone, somebody. And I've found in the couples I've worked with over the years, they usually end up blaming each other for why they're in the financial situation they're in. And so we fought really, really hard to not blame each other. And we fought really, really hard to come up with ways that would remind us both that this is a season. This don't have to be always. This is a season. And so our mantra was, every time we saw a car, like one of our old cars, or a nice house, or just, you know, people looking all nice and looking like they was just eating whatever they wanted to eat. You know, they wasn't even paying attention to the price on the menu. We used to look at each other and go, been there, done that on the way back. Been there, done that on the way back. And it was our daily thing. Anything we saw, been there, done that on the way back. So that it just was a reminder that we not only is this temporal, like not only is this not going to be who we are forever, but it was very much our thing. We had to develop something that we can each hold on to, but hold on to it together. So at a time when a lot of the people we knew in the real estate industry, you know, that was where I came from as a real estate and mortgage broker, I would say, man, probably 70, 80% of the people we knew divorced in that season by 2010. I think we're still to this day from our original people who were married around that time. We might be the only couple left. I really don't recall anyone else who was married, that stayed married. And I think it's because we came up with those one-liners that we could just both hold on to. And it made us feel like we're in it together and we're not fighting each other. And we really didn't fight each other during that season. Sometimes people, you know, will ask, we didn't really fight each other, but we did fight together.
That's awesome.
That's powerful right there. Yeah. We didn't fight each other. We fought together. Mm-hmm. So y'all need to fight together.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
Because it's not us against each other. It's us against the problem. Like, we're in a problem. We in a pickle. This is beyond a pickle now, right? It's us coming together to find the solution, find a solution. If we're beefing, how do we find the solution? And we know that that's a tactic of the enemy, right? Put you against each other. And now you guys can't get on one accord and find a way like out together. So that's one thing. Even now, you know, what that led us to do, I think I share about this in the book, but we have weekly money meetings. So money, we call it Money Mondays, but every Monday at 9 a.m. Eastern, we get either here at the conference table, my office, or the dining room table, and we just go through money. We go through what the calendar is. Like, we go through what are the big expenditures we have coming up. Is there anything out of the ordinary we need to talk about? I catch him up on the balances of how our accounts are doing. Like, that is a habit. We've been more consistent the last like 4 or 5 years, but it started even when we was like, well, we got $82. So what would you like to do? Like, because we need this for gas for the yellow van. That the getting in the habit of that started back then when we were trying to figure it out. So it wasn't like, oh, now you got money, let's figure, you know, now let's start being proactive. We started to become proactive back then.
So good. As you guys see, you need to get your hand on Patrice, on her book. Tell everybody where they can find your book and how they can keep in touch with you.
Yeah, you can come to patricewashington.com to find the book, and you'll get links to retailers there. And my most active social media is Instagram. I would say that's a good place to just like tag me. Let me know that you found me through Ty and Talit. Yeah, that's where I play it. Seek Wisdom PCW. So Seek Wisdom PCW.
That's right. Awesome. The book is called Redefining Wealth for Yourself. Yes. And we will have it linked in the show notes and in the description under this video. Y'all need it. Trust
you us need it.
When we tell you that. Go get it right now. Patrice, thank you.
Thank you so much
for coming and unpacking this, because this is something that we all need to take a hard look at. You know, wealth doesn't start with dollars and cents. That's right. It starts with you. And so if you get yourself together, mm-hmm. then you will be able to steward and be entrusted with wealth like never before. So we highly suggest that you go get this book. It's a fantastic blueprint for you to follow on this journey. Thank you, Patrice.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys. Always a pleasure.
Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen.
That was so good.
Of course it was.
Like,
it was
you all should probably like listen to this again mm-hmm. or watch it again if you're watching this on YouTube. Mm-hmm. This was a very, very good episode. Make sure that you all grab her book. Again, all the links will be in the show notes or the description box. Get your hands on this book. It will definitely help you and change your life.
100. Share this in your IG stories. Let everybody know they need to listen to this and tag us at His and Her Money. That's all we got for this time, guys. It's been great. Until next time. Peace.
Bye, y'all.